Welcome to our seminar series, Prophetic Time. Today's topic is very, very, very interesting. The Antichrist tampers with prophetic time. Yes, the Antichrist tampers with prophetic time. Did you ever hear about the secret rapture? Just watch this clip.
You're all we talked about. He said that you were the greatest baseball player in the whole world. And you know what?
What?
He's right.
I love you.
Did you just see what happened? Is this biblical? Will people just vanish from this earth? I constantly get messages now these days from people saying the rapture is going to take place any time now, since the tribulation is going to take place any moment now, and they will escape the tribulation and they will just vanish to heaven. Is this biblical truth? My friend, stay tuned for the rest of this presentation. This is really crucial. So this seminar will unmask this fallacy of this secret rapture that will happen now in the, say, near future. And we will see exactly in this seminar and especially the next seminars where we are in time. So are you aware that we are living in biblical time? Do you want to understand where we are in the stream of prophetic time, my friend? Then these seminars are for you. We are busy building the foundation and framework. In the first three seminars, we laid the foundation. Now we are busy building the framework. In this presentation, the previous one, and also the next, where we will then have a platform and the framework and structure from where we can then understand where we are in time. We saw in the first seminar, the time deception of atheism, that God is a reality and time is a reality. We saw in the second seminar, time in your future, Jesus is a reality and prophecy is a reality. And then in the third presentation, we saw the ABC of prophetic time, that the Bible is a reality and prophetic time is a reality. My friend, in the previous seminar, the Antichrist time is already here. We unmask the Antichrist as the papal system. Now, in this presentation and the next, we will finish the framework and then we can head off with a seminar from seminar number 7 to the last one, number 10, to see exactly where we are in time. And I will make it simple. We will have detailed timelines so that we can understand exactly what is going on at this very moment. So let's start with this presentation. The Antichrist tampers with prophetic time. My friend, I want to ask you a question. Are you a Protestant? I believe most viewers that are viewing this will be a Protestant. Are you a Protestant? If so, what are you protesting? Ever thought about that? Why do you call yourself a Protestant? You see, the Protestant Reformation were brought about in protest to the Antichrist system, in protest to the Roman system. Are you following? Here's the picture of Martin Luther. He went to that door at Wittenberg and he nailed the 95 theses against that door, stating, "I cannot agree with this system. It is unbiblical." And the Reformation were capitulated, and it started from there. We see that the reformers, starting with the morning star John Wycliffe, all of them were in harmony, corresponding exactly that the Antichrist system is none else than the Roman Catholic papal system. Friends, we already identified this in the previous seminar. If you didn't watch that seminar, please go and have a look at that. John Wycliffe, he was the first to translate the Bible into the English language. He said, "Why is it necessary in unbelief to look for another Antichrist? Hence, in the 7th chapter of Daniel, Antichrist is forcefully described by a horn arising in the time of the 4th kingdom. For so, our clergy foresee the Lord Pope, as it is said of the 8th blaspheming little head." So he identified the Pope and the Roman Catholic system as the Antichrist system. Amazing. Then we have William Tyndale, the first one to translate the Bible directly from the Greek language into English. What did he say? He said, "The Pope's forbidding matrimony and to eat of meat created of God for man's use, which is devilish doctrine by Paul's prophecy, are tokens good enough that he's the right Antichrist and his doctrine sprung from the devil." Wow. So they didn't spare any words here. They exposed the Antichrist. Martin Luther, the well-known Martin Luther, who protested the Catholic Church and started the Reformation. He said, "We here are of the conviction that the papacy is the seat of the true and real Antichrist. Personally, I declare that I owe the Pope no other obedience than that to Antichrist." These are very hard words, my friend. But it's true. And the reformers stood for truth. Some of them were persecuted. Some of them lost their lives. Some of them were martyred. But they stood for truth, my friend. You see, this totalitarian regime that ran through the dark ages, the Antichrist system, my friend, the Bible said, and we saw in the previous section, the previous presentation, that they lost their reign and power in 1798, exactly like the Bible predicted. But they will regain world dominion in our time. The wound will be healed. So you can understand then why they had these hard words when showing and referring to the Antichrist. "I despise," Martin Luther said, "and attack it as impious, false. It is Christ himself who is condemned therein. I rejoice in having to bear such ills for the best of causes. Already I feel greater liberty in my heart, for at last I know that the Pope is Antichrist and that his throne is that of Satan himself." Friends, when you see what they went through, you will understand where they are coming from. And all they are just doing is exposing the Antichrist with the Word of God. Swingley, he was a reformer in Switzerland, said, "I know that in it works the might and power of the devil, that is of the Antichrist. The papacy has to be abolished, but by no other means can it be more thoroughly rooted than by the Word of God." And Thomas Cranmer, he was a leader in the Anglican Church. He said, "Accordingly, it follows that Rome is the very seat of the Antichrist and the Pope himself the very Antichrist. I could prove the same through many other scriptures, old writers and strong reasons." And then John Knox, that Scottish reformer, he said, "As for your Roman Church, it is now corrupted. I no more doubt but that it is the synagogue of Satan, and the head thereof called the Pope to be the man of sin, of whom the apostle speaketh." My friends, if preachers would preach this today, they would be almost thrown into jail. This is politically incorrect. But these were our forefathers, the reformers, from where we came as Protestants. And they protested against the Antichrist system, my friend, so that they could not rule the world again. John Calvin, the leader of the French and Swiss Reformation, said, "I deny him to be the vicar of Christ, who in furiously persecuting the gospel demonstrates by his conduct that he is Antichrist. I deny him to be the successor of Peter. I deny him to be the head of the church. Some persons think us too severe." Please listen to this, because you can hear these quotes I'm quoting now and think, what? Why are you quoting this severe quotes? Let Calvin explain this. "Some persons think us too severe and censorious when we call the Roman pontiff Antichrist. But those who are of this opinion do not consider that they bring the same charge of presumption against Paul himself, after whom we speak and whose language we adopt. I shall briefly show that Paul's words in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 are not capable of any other interpretation. My friend, when you look at Oliver Cromwell, the English military and political leader, it is quite amazing to see how he reacted to anything that has to do with the Roman Catholic system.
Grant us the spirit of thy grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Who has done this? Answer me. Who has done this?
An edict, squire, from the Archbishop himself, and by order of the King.
By order of the King? Is the Church of England not a Protestant church? Would the King turn the house of God into a Roman temple?
Mr. Cromwell, I beseech you. Does the King think that God can be bought with gold, trinkets, and gilded rubbish? I know only that I have been instructed.
Has this king forgotten the Reformation?
Mr. Cromwell,
away with this popish idolatry! Did the Lord not say unto Moses, thou shalt not make unto thyself any graven image? Now bow down to them! Has this king forgotten the Spanish Inquisition?
Incredible. John Wesley, founder of the Methodist Church, writer of many hymns. He is in an emphatical sense the man of sin, as he increases all manner of sin above measure. And he is too properly styled the son of perdition, as he has caused the death of numberless multitudes, both of his opposers and followers. We saw that history tells us that over 100 million people were martyred and put to death by this system through the Dark Ages. And Wesley says that is why we know it fulfilled prophecy. It is the Antichrist system. Wesley further continues and says, he it is that exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, claiming the highest power and highest honor, claiming their prerogatives which belong to God alone. And we saw even Pope Francis today in his letters refer to himself as the vicar of Christ. He's taking the place of Christ on earth. Question. So what about today's Protestant leaders? What about today's Protestants? Are they protesting? Are they protesting the Catholic system or the Pope? No, my friend. When you go to the World Council of Churches and their website, you see many churches, all the main denominations listed, all coming together. And who is really in control of the World Council of Churches? The Catholic Church, because they are not a member, but they are controlling it. Because they don't regard them as the daughters. They are the mother church. They are the universal, the Catholic, meaning universal church. When I traveled to Germany in 2017, I was visiting the church of where Martin Luther preached, and then the church of Wittenberg, and there you... On my way to the church where he preached more than 2,000 sermons, you can see the two towers in the back, was this sign, and I took a photo. World Reformation Exhibition, the Ecumenism and Religion Gate. Martin Luther will turn around in his grave. He stood for truth, and now the whole Reformation is being undone. Yes, it's been undone by having all the religions come together again, having all the denominations and all the Protestants coming together under the banner of Catholicism. It's incredible. Everything for the common goal, the common union and common witness. It says here the Lutheran World Federation. This is the Lutheran Church. In the pursuit of communion and common witness. And there they signed documents in the church, the very church where Martin Luther preached, against this system. And there they are coming together and joining hands. Reformed churches endorse Catholic Lutheran accord on key Reformation dispute. Isn't that amazing? Not only Reformed churches and other Protestant denominations, but even Pentecostals, my friend. One of the main proponents in the Pentecostal movement and leaders are Kenneth Copeland and James Robertson. And here they are meeting with Pope Francis, meeting and seeing how they can bring back all the Protestants back to the mother church, the Catholic Church. Please quickly watch this video of Kenneth Copeland.
This brought an end to the protest of Luther. Brothers and sisters, Luther's protest is over. Is yours?
Oh. Glory, glory, glory. Tony, thank you, sir. Come on, the man asked us to pray for him. Oh, Father. Father, we answer his request. And since we know not how to pray for him as we ought, other than to agree with him in his quest and in his heart for the unity of the body of Christ. We come together in the unity of our faith. Hallelujah.
He had Tony Palmer, this Catholic priest, come and present in his church, and the Reformation's over, it is over. And then Copeland and his church is rejoicing and praying in the Spirit. We are going back to the Mother Church. Here you have Rick Warren greeting and fellowshipping with Pope Francis, endorsing the agenda of unity. My friend, John 17, the Catholic Sun unites Catholics and Protestants for day of prayer. And Pope Francis says it is the devil who divides Protestants and Catholics. Can you see that the Reformation is being undone? But you can say, but unity is a good thing. Of course unity is a good thing. Of course Christians should come together. But my friend, we cannot come together in error. We can only come together in truth. Otherwise, we are endorsing what the Bible warned us against, and we will become part of the prophecy of Revelation chapter 13. Don't miss that seminar. And I will show you how the whole world, with the Christian influence from the Antichrist system, will be coerced to receive the mark of the beast. That is why we can't just join in unity if it is not in truth. So why do today's Protestants no longer acknowledge and recognize the papacy as the Antichrist? My friend, Gleanings newspaper says how Antichrist to brother in Christ. How Protestant pastors view the Pope. And these days they view him as a moral leader, as a spiritual leader from God. Whereas in this article it says years before, and much of the older pastors and the old reformers said it is the Antichrist. No, now we know better. How did this happen? How did Rome succeed to bring about this change? Of course, they had the Vatican II Council meetings in the 1960s, and there they told the world, we've changed, we've changed. There was no change, my friends. It was just a change of color, but there were no doctrinal changes. But how did they do this? Rome could not keep up with the spread of Protestantism. She could not eradicate it, not even prevent it. For papal Rome was now marked as the Antichrist. And with this label of Antichrist, the papacy was exposed. It was just too clear that this time prophecy of their reign of 1260 years were in your face, now being exposed by the reformers and the Reformation. How would they get rid of this time prophecy? How would they get rid of this label of the Antichrist? What could they do? So in counter-reaction to the Protestant Reformation, Rome convened the Council of Trent, which lasted from 1545 to 1563. The Reformation was investigated as well as their own doctrines, and in this council they affirmed every doctrine and condemned Protestantism as heresy. They then devised a way to shift the focus from themselves, where the reformers referred to them as the Antichrist according to Bible prophecy. Thus, they delegated two Jesuits to prove that the papacy is not the Antichrist. So the first Jesuit were Louis d'Alcazar, father of preterism. And he wrote a dissertation. It's like he wrote a doctorate. Showing out a biblical apocalyptic prophecy that the Antichrist and these prophecies were fulfilled way back in the past. So instead, and please note this, instead of having then this long period of a papal reign or Antichrist reign, now you have a small period way back in John's time. Isn't that incredible? So the focus were removed from the Antichrist. But for those who didn't believe this, let us give them another theory. So Francisco Ribera came up with another theory. He's then the father of futurism, and he came up with futurism. Prophetic faith says he assigned the first few chapters of the apocalypse to ancient Rome in John's own time. The rest he restricted to a literal 3.5 year reign of an infidel Antichrist who would bitterly oppose and blaspheme the saints just before the second advent. He taught that the Antichrist would be a single individual who would rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, abolish the Christian religion, deny Christ, be received by the Jews, pretend to be God, and conquer the world all in this brief space of 3.5 literal years. My friends, so instead of this time period found in Bible prophecy of 1,260 years, it made it literal years, 3.5 years, and threw it in the distant future. So now the label of the Antichrist was removed from the papacy. The papacy accepted both views because it wasn't meant teaching Catholic believers, but to confuse Protestants and eventually undermine the Reformation. And so, my friend, what do we have? We have a distant and a future fulfillment of the Antichrist prophecies, but there's nothing in between for all these hundreds, more than 1,000 years. That prophecy is just completely removed. My friends, when you look at apocalyptic prophecy, we see that it is highly symbolical and should be understood symbolically. But when you look at these theories that are being proposed and then now believed by millions, you actually see what is happening with prophecy. For instance, let's just quickly view these schools of interpretation. Preterism. The prophecies were fulfilled around the author's day. Now, there you have the timeline of the author's day, history, and future. So preterism basically placed all the prophecies around the author's day and close to the author's day. Now, I'm studying this quite in depth. I'm busy doing my doctoral dissertation on preterism, futurism, and historicism, and basically showing people that historicism is the biblical method. So you can see here, this doesn't even logically make sense. Because why will the Bible give prophecies if it's only for that small time period and even call it denoting to the future, but it's actually to the past? That doesn't make sense. Then futurism. In this prophetic school of interpretation, it says the prophecies will be fulfilled in the distant future during the end times, far from the author's day. So here on the timeline, you will see far in the future, these prophecies of Revelation, for instance, will be fulfilled. There's no other application then. But when you come to historicism, the prophecies are fulfilled over the course of history from the author's day to the end of time. And so you can see the whole timeline are filled. Historicism are tracing God's prophecies through time to the end of time, from the author's day. That just makes logically sense, my friend. And of course, you have another one, idealism. The prophecies just teach us good spiritual lessons. So there's no actual time. There's no time, basically. It is just, it's good lessons wherever you are in history. So preterism, quickly, let me just summarize this for today. We have many proponents. I'm just going to refer to one. He died not long ago, R.C. Sproul. He's a very conservative person, was a very good lecturer and preacher. But he said and teach that these prophecies were already fulfilled in the past. Incredible. I have some of his books. And even books are being written about this, the last temple, the last sacrifice, the last disciple. And they even have movies being made with this notion incorporated into them. I don't know if you know the series AD that shows you what happened after the crucifixion in the early days of Christianity. These are all based, you know, with this notion. And then you have futurism. Now, futurism is very interesting where it comes from. You know, preterism, there's quite a number of proponents. But the popular one, the real popular one today is futurism. Preterism is rising. Don't underestimate it. And I believe we're going to see quite a rise in preterism. There's much more to it. I don't have time in this presentation. This will cover many presentations. But when you look at futurism, you see that it's incredible where it came from. Despite from Ribera in the 1500s that formulated this theory, it was adopted by another Jesuit priest in South America, Manuel de la Cunza, in 1790. And he wrote a whole book using these principles, these futuristic principles. He, of course, used another name to Johann Josaphat Ben Ezra, and he published it under this name, and he termed it in English, the book's name was The Coming of the Messiah in Majesty and Glory. Now, a Scottish Presbyterian, Edward Irving, in Europe, he read this book and translated it into English, The Coming of the Messiah in Majesty and Glory. So then John Nelson Darby read this work in the USA, and he came up with this system of dispensationalism. And who wrote his and who read his works? Cyrus Ingerson Schofield. He was then the author of the popular Schofield Reference Bible. My friend, so he wanted to make it very simple for people to understand the Bible, especially prophecies. So he had comments in this Bible, and up till today, millions of these Bibles were sold and are still being sold. Lewis Perry Chafer, he was the author of the popular 8-volume systematic books for theologians. There it is. I just bought it the other day for myself. It is now condensed, not condensed, just put into 4 volumes. But still the same amount of pages. Incredible books. But these books are basically conditioning the theologian to think in terms of dispensations and futurism. And I'll explain that in a moment. Lewis Perry Chafer was the founder and served as the first president of the Dallas Theological Seminary. And he was influential in the support of dispensationalism. So he started Dallas. We have many well-known theologians and authors coming from Dallas. Who's one of them? Pastor Hal Lindsey. He graduated from Dallas Theological Seminary, and he wrote the book, the well-known book, The Late Great Planet Earth. Here's different copies over different time periods. It sold more than 30 million copies in 30 languages, written in 1970, I think. Incredible, absolutely incredible. And then, closer to our time, in 1995 to 2007, there were 16 books written and released by Tim LaHaye and Jerry B. Jenkins, The Left Behind series, showing how the rapture will take place and the tribulation will start and the Antichrist will set himself up in Jerusalem. It's just incredible. Now, please note this. You have futurism, you have preterism. Both being set in the tone of fiction and people buying and reading it. There you see it. Left Behind, The Last Temple. Guess what? Published by the same publishing house, Tyndale House Publishers. Isn't that amazing? Tyndale, I just showed you Tyndale what he said about the Antichrist. He will turn around in his grave. That under his name, such nonsense is published. Here's Tim LaHaye signing books, and his partner Jerry B. Jenkins signing books. The books are just selling in the thousands. They even adapted it to children's books. Yes, you've heard it right. 40 children's books in this Left Behind series. Incredible. 1 million copies sold is here on the cover. And please note there on the cover, it says second chance. Can you see the danger of this theory, my friend? Because it learns that maybe you are not raptured, but you will have a second chance to repent during the tribulation. You know, so it gives us a false sense of security. Kirk Cameron were featured in the Left Behind movies from 2000, then the follow-up in 2002, then another follow-up in 2005. They even put it into PC games. There was three PC games from 2006 onwards. And then in 2014, Nicolas Cage, Left Behind. You saw the clip in the beginning. That was from that movie. Incredible. Even Hollywood, because there's money and people believe it. You see, you can watch the movie and think, I don't believe it. My friend, the world is being conditioned by this. And that is why they can't see then the truth of Scripture. So when you look at futurism, based on dispensation teaching, they teach that there are seven different dispensations. The dispensation of innocence, conscience, government, promise, law, grace, and kingdom. Now, let's quickly go through these dispensations, because Schaefer, who started Dallas Theological Seminary, said, a dispensation is a period of time during which man is tested in respect to obedience to some specific revelation of the will of God. So he's a systematic theologian, and he's basically saying that God is working differently with different people in different times and ages. That is not biblical, my friend. But let's quickly look at the theory. The first dispensation, the dispensation of innocence. They say the very first dispensation in which Adam and Eve were in paradise was the dispensation of innocence, because they had no knowledge of good and evil. Really? God made the world perfect, and they say they had no knowledge of good and evil, which means it is a bad thing? The Bible says, then God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. God made it very good, and he made man according to his image, my friend. They were perfect, in a perfect environment. Actually, this theory then teaches us that the farther the world grows, the smarter it becomes. No, that sounds to me like evolution. It is the other way around. There's actually devolution happening over time. The second dispensation is the dispensation of conscience. For a long time after the fall of man, man distinguished between good and evil by the voice of his conscience. He had no other precepts to follow. My friend, really? Only a conscience? The Bible says, Romans 4:15, where there's no law, there's no transgression. Genesis 6 verse 8 says, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. So, question. They say the law only comes much later, and that grace even comes much later during the church period. But the Bible says there can't be transgression without law. So God's law was there. Adam and Eve couldn't fall if there was no law, if they could not disobey. You can only disobey with law. The Bible says there was law. And Noah, how did Noah found grace in this time period if there was no grace? If he had only conscience, you know, and no, my friend, they knew God's will. The dispensation of human governments after the flood. After the flood, the Lord made a covenant with Noah and subsequently held the leaders of family groups or people responsible for the decisions and the welfare of their followers. So now they are evolving a bit more, you know, from just basically being dumb and stupid in the Garden of Eden, then evolving to just hearing their conscience and making decisions like they think because there's no law. Now up to the next dispensation where the leaders in the families are teaching them. No, my friend. The Bible says, Deuteronomy chapter 24, 16, parents are not to be put to death for their children, nor children put to death for their parents. Each will die for their own sin. Which means that there's personal responsibility. That these leaders within the families couldn't take responsibility for the sins of their children. Are you following? It is because there was law. They knew God's will. Then there's the dispensation of promise. In this dispensation, because God makes so many promises to Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, they are tested and saved by their faithfulness to the promise and covenant. My friend, you are not saved by your obedience. You can only be saved by grace through faith in Jesus. And throughout all ages, people were saved by grace through faith. All ages. Now they say, Abram was only saved, you know, there was no law, no grace yet. He was only saved by believing God's promise. No. Genesis 26:5 says, because Abram obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes and my laws. Clearly, the Bible states that in Abram's time, there was law. And now, the next dispensation, the dispensation of the law. The dispensation of the law at Sinai, the dispensation of the law began, in which the distinction between good and evil was much more explicitly stated. Only now, after many years, God gives law and helps them to recognize exactly, you know, what is right and what is wrong. No, my friend. You know, this whole theory is skewed. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people, which means that everyone received grace from God throughout all ages. Psalms 51 verse 11 says, cast me not away from thy presence and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Which means that even in the time period of the law, where David lived, he had access to the Holy Spirit. This is Bible, my friend. This is not my words. Then the dispensation of grace. The dispensation of grace is also called the dispensation of the church or the Holy Spirit. After the crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit was poured out to restore people and guide them into all truth. And now this theory says, now and only now, God can give the Holy Spirit. Now and only now, God is giving grace. And now we don't need the law no longer. My friend, and they use this verse, Romans 6:14, because you are not under the law, but under grace. So the law, the age of law is gone. They were saved by law. Now we are saved by grace. Really? No, my friends. Even if you look at this verse, you are not under the law, but under the grace. It's taken out of context. Let's read the whole verse in context. For sin shall no longer be your master because you are not under the law but under grace. What then shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? By no means. The Bible makes it clear that being under grace means that God is giving us power from on high. It doesn't mean that there's no law and the law doesn't apply to my life. The verse is very clear. It's in the New Testament. That is why Jesus said in John chapter 14 verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. John 15:10, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. 1 John 5:3 says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. Please note, it's in the New Testament, given during the so-called church period or Holy Spirit dispensation or dispensation of grace. My friend, God is the same, according to the Bible, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, God will never, ever change. The dispensation of the kingdom, the last dispensation, they say, this is the millennial reign. True believers of all time will reign with Christ in his kingdom. Okay, so let's quickly summarize how they view the end time. They have the period of grace, the church period. So they say, okay, we are now in the dispensation of the church or grace or the Holy Spirit. And in this dispensation, suddenly the believers, those who are ready for Christ, will be raptured to heaven. Okay, so they will be taken away. Doof. And all of us will be left behind. So now we are here on this earth. The believers are taken to heaven. Now the tribulation will start. Please look at the graph. The seals will be poured out from Revelation. The trumpets will be poured out from Revelation. The plagues will be poured out from Revelation. And it will be a 7-year period divided into two. You will have a 3.5-year period where the temple will be rebuilt in Jerusalem. And after that, the Antichrist will set himself up as God in the temple in Jerusalem. And he will reign for a 3.5-year period. And then God will come with a third coming and just destroy the Antichrist system and the Antichrist and everything. and he will come and reign on earth, and then the kingdom and eternity will start with 1,000 years of peace, etc. So this is the main one. There's some variations to some of the viewpoints, but this is the main viewpoint. So where on earth do they get this period of 7 years divided into 3.5 and 3.5? Do you remember in our second seminar when we established that Jesus is the true Messiah? We saw this amazing prophecy in Daniel chapter 9. Let me just put up the graph on the screen. You remember the 490-year prophecy? And we saw how it led to the exact time of Jesus when he was anointed, when he was crucified, and the gospel went to the world. Isn't that amazing? We saw even the depth of how the wise men knew the exact time of his birth. But that's, go and watch that seminar if you didn't. Now, here's the graph. We saw it historically confirmed. This theory takes the same time prophecy, and this is what they do with it. They split it up. They believe and state that yes, it leads up to Jesus' baptism, but no more than that. They take the last 7 years of the prophecy and throw it into the far distant unknown future, because there's no date for the coming of Christ or the rapture. So they just break God's prophecy. You can see, as I just illustrated there on the screen, it is broken. Let me just go back to that part of the 7 years on the screen. So now, instead of Jesus dying in the middle of the week, I've put a cross upside down, because they say, no, it's actually the Antichrist. The Antichrist sets himself up in the middle of the week, this prophetic week, and he proclaims himself to be Messiah. And he makes a covenant with the world. My friend, this is so skew. This is so unbiblical. And then they say during the 3.5 year period, the temple's rebuilt, and then the Antichrist is in the temple for 3.5 years, and then the third coming. This is just crazy, my friend. You cannot break God's prophecy. This is the result of the Antichrist tampering with prophetic time, my friend. This is the result of the Counter-Reformation in the 1500s, where they came up with these two theories that it's either the far past or the distant future. Preterism and futurism. Away is the label from the Antichrist. So let's look and see if there's any biblical truth to the theory of the rapture. Okay? Here's the graph. So, is it a secret rapture? We should ask the Bible. Is it a secret rapture? They say some will be taken to heaven and the others left behind on earth. Is that biblical? And then, is there an Antichrist that will reign before Jesus comes with his glorious coming? Let's ask the Bible. So, three main issues in the secret rapture teaching. It is a secret coming. Believers are taken together and unbelievers are left behind. And the Antichrist appears after the rapture. So let's look at the secret coming. They say that Christ is coming like a thief, quietly and secretly. Is that what Scripture is teaching, my friend? Revelation chapter 16, 15, Jesus says, "Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame." Question, is there any notion in this verse that Jesus is coming silently and secretly? No. What is in this verse is that he's coming unexpectedly. And therefore, we should keep our garments. We should be ready at all times. We should watch and be ready. Let's go to the next verse they use as this thief secret notion. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 1 and 2 says, "But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a what? As a thief in the night." Oh, there you have it. He's coming secretly. No. Let's read further. You can't take it out of context. The next part of the verse says, "For when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction." Let me just stop there. What? Sudden destruction. So when Jesus comes, sudden destruction. Does that sound silently, secretly to you? Sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. So why will Christ portray himself coming as a thief? Read the verse. That last part says, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. Which means that it will take you unexpectedly. You should be ready, because you don't know when exactly to expect Jesus to come. We don't have a date of the day and the hour. Isn't that amazing? Then this is the verse that is being used for the secret rapture. This is the main central verse. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 16. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Question, does that verse sound secret and silent to you? It's just the exact opposite. There's the shout, the voice, and the trumpet of Jesus, because he's excited to come and gather his children from this world. Isn't that amazing? There's no secrecy to this verse, my friend. Up till today, I can't see how with proper biblical exegesis you can come up with a secret rapture within this verse. It is impossible. And yet, it is the verse that is quoted. The next part of the verse says, then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And they say, you see, we are caught up. Nowhere you see it will be a secret vanishing and just clothing left behind. 2 Peter 2 verse 10. This verse are always quoted to show that Jesus will come as a thief. But only the first part of the verse is quoted, my friend. I'm going to read now the whole verse. Put on your seatbelt, because this is shocking. 2 Peter 3 verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. Yes, he's coming secretly. No, read the rest of the verse, my friend. In which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. My friend, the world will end as we know it when Jesus comes as a thief. Because the notion of thief denotes you are caught by surprise. It happens unexpectedly, not secretly. The heavens will pass away. This world will be burned up when Jesus comes, my friend. Nothing will remain. The world as we know it will be no longer. So the second crux of the secret rapture teaching is believers are taken and unbelievers are left behind. And these are the words that are being used for movies and books, etc. Left behind. Believers are taken and unbelievers are left behind. Is this biblical? Is it biblical that there will only be clothes left behind and all of us, the unbelievers, will be left behind? And why I'm saying it the whole time, referring to myself being left behind, now we will see why I say I will be left behind. Luke chapter 17 from verse 26 to 27. And as it was in the days of Noah. So, if you want to understand what will happen with the second coming and around the second coming of Christ, you should study the days of Noah. What happened there? Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will also be in the days of the Son of Man. They ate, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And the flood came and destroyed them all. Okay? So the flood came and did what? The flood came and took them all. Let's go to Genesis 7 and let's clarify this. So he, that is God, destroyed all living things which were on the face of the ground, both man and cattle, creeping thing and bird of the air. They were destroyed from the earth. Question. question. According to the Bible, who is taken from the earth? Who's taken from the earth in Noah's time? All the unbelievers, even all the animals. They were taken from the earth. They were destroyed from the earth. Who were left behind? Only Noah and those who are with him in the ark remained or were left behind alive. Isn't that amazing? Who were left behind? Only the believers. It is the exact opposite, my friend. Those who are taken are those who are destroyed. And those who are left behind or remain are those who are alive. It's those who are saved. It's the believers. That is why the parallel of the ark and Noah is a crucial one to understand what will happen. And let's read another verse and you will see this for yourself. It's not my words. This is the words of Jesus. Luke chapter 17 from verse 34 and onward. I tell you, in that night, there will be two men in one bed. The one will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding together. The other one will be taken and the other left. Two men will be in the field. The one will be taken and the other left. Question before I continue. The Bible says there will be two men sleeping. The one will be taken and the other one will be left. Do we know where the one is taken to? No, this part of the verse doesn't tell us. Do we know where the one is left? Yes, in the bed. Two women will be grinding together. The one will be taken and the other left. Do we know where the one woman is being taken to? No, we don't. Not yet. And the other left? Yes, she's still busy grinding. Okay. And then two men will be in the field. The one will be taken and the other left. So we know that the left, he's still in the field. Taken, we don't know yet. Now, the disciples wants to know, where are they taken? Not where are they left. We know where they are left. Where are they taken? And they answered and said to him, where, Lord? Where are they taken? We don't know that part of the question yet. So he said to them, wherever the body is, there the eagles will be gathered together. They are dead. Those who are taken are those who die at Jesus' coming. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 19, the birds will feed on all the carcasses of the people that will die with his second coming. Isn't that amazing? Which shows us that this theory of the secret rapture is the exact opposite again. Those who are taken are those who are dead. And those who are left behind are those who are alive and then caught up together so that they can go with Jesus to heaven. Isn't that amazing? Matthew 13:30 says, let both grow together until the harvest. And at the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the what? The tares. So when Jesus comes, he's first going to deal with the unbelievers. First gather together the what? The tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them. So first of all, Christ deals with the unbelievers and they are destroyed. They are taken. Like the flood took everything, they are taken. And those who are left behind, but gather the wheat into my barn. Those who are left behind will be gathered together to the Lord. Amen. The Bible is clear. And then the third part of the secret rapture theory is the Antichrist appears after the rapture. Is that the case, my friend? That there will be this one Antichrist individual that appears after the rapture? The Bible says very clearly in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 from verse 1, now brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and your gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, or that is worship, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Did you note? That day will not come unless the falling away comes first. First the Antichrist, and then the coming of Christ. Isn't that clear enough? So this notion that the Antichrist will only come after Jesus' coming is the exact opposite again. Can you see how Satan is always turning the truth upside down? And this is what the Antichrist system did, my friend, through preterism and futurism, is basically concocting a new theory, the exact opposite of Scripture, so that the label of Antichrist can be removed from the papacy. Friends, historicism is the only biblical method to understand apocalyptic prophecy, understanding it from the author's day right through history up till the end of time. But the prophecy said in Daniel chapter 7:25 that the Antichrist will remove it. He will try to change it. So what happened? He came up with this fallacy of preterism and futurism. And gone out of the view is this prophecy, this time prophecy where the papacy is identified as the Antichrist. It's a very smart move, my friend, but God prophesied this move. In Daniel chapter 7 verse 25, God said that the Antichrist will tamper with prophetic time so that we can't identify it. The Bible says, and I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. We see this time prophecy, my friend. The wound came into play in 1798. And the Pope was taken captive. But the Bible says, and his deadly wound was healed. In our time, we can see the deadly wound being healed, my friend. And the Bible says, all the world marveled and followed the beast. All the world is following the Pope as a moral leader, my friend. And now, don't miss the next seminars, my friend, where we will see how all of this fits in so that we can see what's going to happen in our day and where we are standing in time. Why does God give prophecy? God gives prophecy as a light in a dark world, my friend, so that you can have hope and you can have certainty. This, we are not studying this to name and shame. We're not studying this to make fun of anyone, my friend. I have nothing against Catholic people. I love Catholic people. Most of them are good Christian people. They're my brother and sister in Jesus. But the system, my friends, are corrupt, and Satan is using the system. This is biblical. And we will see in our day what's going to happen according to Bible prophecy. God gave prophecies alike, my friend. The Bible says 2 Peter 1 verse 19, and so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Do you want to have the morning star rising in your heart? Do you want to have a deeper relationship with Jesus, my friend? Then prophecy is the answer. Why? Because prophecy shows us not only where we are in time, it shows us where we are with God. And my friends, as we study prophetic scriptures, we see God being revealed more and more. Jesus wants a relationship with you, my friend. And Jesus wants to give you hope and certainty. But you may ask, why are we then studying about the Antichrist? Did you hear yourself saying that? Antichrist? Because it's about Christ. And Satan is attacking Christ. And in these days, we see just more and more. We need to study this so that we can know the truth about Christ. Are you following? Yes, absolutely. So that we won't be deceived. God wants to bless you, my friend. Let's do a prayer together. Father, what a wonderful privilege that we could study your word. Oh, Father, free us from error. May we know the truth and may the truth set us free. Oh, Father, we pray that we will be solidly standing on your word of truth. Bless the viewer now watching, Father. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Don't miss the next seminar, my friend. The Antichrist changes God's time.